Rocket brings the title back to Storrs in 2013. It's another perfect ending for UConn. UConn has done it again for the 10th time.
The national championship goes to Connecticut for the fourth year in a row as the dynasty fulfills its destiny.
Welcome to the NCAA Women's Championship presented by Capital One. Today it's game two from Bridgeport. The number one undefeated, unbelievable UConn Huskies facing number four seed UCLA for a spot in another Elite Eight on Monday night. Now the winner will get the Cinderella Oregon Ducks, who upset third seed Maryland today. That was an outstanding performance by the Ducks. Three consecutive upsets. But moments ago, here's Gino Auriemma inside his locker room.
Every possession matters. No possession's off. Every possession matters. So we play every possession, play it out. And then every TV timeout, every dead ball, whatever, we'll regroup. But we're going to win every second. Got it, guys? Let's go.
Gino Auriemma at work, the seven-time National Coach of the Year, and his unbelievable team on the court for these starting lineup introductions. Dave O'Brien alongside Carol Austin, Doris Burke, and Holly Rose joining us in just a moment. And it really does, Doris, for UConn, begin with that starting lineup.
Wasn't this supposed to be the year of vulnerability, lack of depth, too many faces and new roles? Well, welcome to the Connecticut Huskies, and the streak keeps on rolling. And you can thank the likes of Nafisa Collier, Katie Lou Samuelson, and Gabby Williams, all of whom have been willing to absorb the weight of the program's history and step into major roles as scorers. They're the only team in the country, Carol Lawson, who's got five players with triple-digit assists. It's been an incredible year.
I tell you, at home, just sit back, relax, and enjoy the beautiful game. And that's what they play. Everyone in concert, everyone in rhythm. They're the main event in the sport. But they're a main event that never disappoints. And that's what makes this team so remarkable.
On the topic of never disappointing, let's go to Holly Rowe.
Well, there's no pressure there. And pressure is the theme of this report, because Corey Close of UCLA has gone to the mountain to learn how Gino Auriemma is doing this. Three times in her course of career at UCLA, she has visited Storrs to find out what is the magic formula. And she said there is none. It is an incredible, relentless attention to detail and holding up high standards in their pace of play, in the way they communicate, and in the whys of what they're doing. She said people can do it, it's just incredibly difficult. But you'll see from her program today, they actually run a lot of the same offense as Connecticut. These teams will look a little bit familiar in that sense, but she said players will make the plays, not the plays.
Thanks, Holly. We take a look at the Capital One starting lineups now for UConn. Samuelson and Nurse are shooting their threes at a tremendous success rate. For UCLA, so much of the Bruins' attack revolves around Jordan Canada and Monique Billings. But if Korver is on from three, they might be able to hang with UConn here today. Getting set for game two. A lot of the UConn fans were walking around in the concourses after game one saying, how about Oregon? They could be a lot of trouble for either of these teams. Underway as the Huskies win the opening tip. And the building is sold out and it is loud. UConn rather well represented as Billings tips that one. Should be off UCLA, and it is.
Good job by Monique Billings on the okey-doke, heading up the floor like, hey, that was off them.
Samuelson to get it in. She's been on fire from the three-point line. Here's Gabby Williams, maybe the best player in the country. Chong, their only senior. Here's Collier off target on the first one. And UCLA coming in with a record of 25-8. Canada, their electric point guard, to knock in two.
And that's the one area of concern if you're the Connecticut Huskies. If Jordan Canada is able to get in transition and operate in space, this is a young woman who's got a bright future at the next level. They've got to contain her.
Yes, she's an All-American, averaging 18 a game. On the entry, kicking out for Chong. That's a round and out. Big rebound, Williams right back up. The All-America Canada.
Wow. Wow. And you know, one of the great matchups in this game is Gabby Williams and Monique Billings, because Monique Billings can do what Gabby Williams just did. That sky almost to the level of the rim.
Korver, and that's a good sign.
Wow, she was deep.
a little bit. Three-point shooter almost exclusively for the Bruins. In the Sweet 16 for the second year in a row. It's the 24th consecutive year for Gina Auriemma. Williams to her left, around and out. Collier, such a hard worker, 9 rebounds a game, but taken away by Billings.
Well, she and Gabby Williams are both forces on the offensive glass. They create extra possessions for Connecticut.
Canada had a 16-assist game in round one of this tournament against Boise State. She's averaging 14 assists a game thus far in the tourney. Korver trying to bounce it inside. That one mishandled by Burke. It'll stay on this end. 8:08 to go here in the very first quarter. UCLA and UConn. It's hard to remember. There was a time when Geno's teams would actually lose on occasion. His first year at UConn, 85-86, they lost 15 games.
Yes, but I'll tell you, as somebody who played against that team, it was a drastic difference from the year prior. And a good execution there by UCLA. But it was an immediate impact in terms of changing of the culture for the Connecticut Huskies and that program when he arrived.
Since 2008, Geno's record, 332 wins, 14 losses. Samuelson with a miss. Williams went up high. It's off her out of play. Well, UCLA with a nice start here.
A great start. And, you know, one of the things they're doing is they're scoring it at a good clip, because that's what you have to be able to do against Connecticut, is put a big number on the board. It's like in golf, when Tiger Woods was at his heyday, you had to put a low number out on Sunday if you wanted to win. You got to put a high number against Connecticut if you want a shot at this thing.
Last went to the Elite Eight, UCLA, in 1999. Trying to get back there. Canada up high. Nice roll, Burke to the basket for two.
Well, you love their countenance on the offensive end. Tremendous read on the backdoor cut.
UCLA has not missed a shot. They're 4-for-4 out of the gate. Williams with the swing here for Nurse. One of the 5 Huskies who have over 100 assists. Samuelson's too strong. Rebound tipped out of play off of Collier. So UCLA with a 9-2 lead in the opening moments. UConn, by the way, the 14th top 25 opponent of the season for UCLA. So they've been tested. And they're 8-5 against that field.
Well, the Pac-12 looking absolutely terrific throughout the course of this tournament, although that's an unforced error there by Canada.
Pac-12 putting 5 teams in the Elite Eight, 2-1 so far. With UCLA playing right now and Oregon State with a shot to make the Elite Eight later on tonight.
Oregon, a team loaded with freshmen, but really talented freshmen. So poised today in their victory over Maryland in the game one upset on this floor. Collier demanding the ball, kicks it back out. Nurse from 3-point land, got it. Well, she tied an NCAA record by hitting 9 threes against Syracuse.
Well, she had to take that time off because of a stress reaction in her ankle. And I think it probably did her some mental and physical good, because she has shot the lights out since she's returned.
Sure has. Coming in averaging 13 points a game, 46% at the 3-point line. Yet another thing the Huskies do exceptionally well. Hayes with the feed and a foul. Williams jumping in there to commit a personal.
I think obviously, Carol, one thing you've got to think about, can't get into foul trouble if you're the Connecticut Huskies. And in the closest games, the most competitive games, Williams or Collier have both been on the bench for stretches because of foul trouble.
Well, those are the two players that you can ill afford to have in foul trouble. If you're Gina Auriemma, it's Collier and Williams. But, you know, the fascinating thing about the matchup is Gabby Williams is so disruptive because she's a higher level athlete than most of the people she plays against. But today she looks across the floor and it's even. It's an even match.
And we asked Billings about that yesterday. I go, it's very rare, Monique, for somebody to be as athletic as you. And she said, I'm really excited for the challenge of that.
Yeah, no back down at all. Another whistle as Samuelson went racing through the lane. And a foul against UCLA. They are 0-3 all time against UConn. It'll go against Kennedy Burke, the 6'1 sophomore for the Bruins, who is an emerging star for UCLA. Williams, nice cut there. Collier finishes. But they look for each other so well. We talked about it. 5 different players who have over 100 assists for the UConn Huskies. That's incredible.
The only team in the country that has all five starters with triple-digit assists.
Here's another example. Nurse is wide open, just can't hit it. Chong with a big rebound. She's the senior who has really come into her own. She said, in past years, I have struggled with consistency. That has not been true in her senior year. Nurse. Collier with the kick. Williams is open. Got it.
You wonder if that's the one player they would concede that jumper to, because that's the last piece of the puzzle for Gabby Williams. When she misses shots, she can get down on herself because she's so hard on herself. But I'll tell you what, she's making that jumper. Look out.
7-0 run here for the Huskies to recover from a 9-2 hole. And they have tied it at 9 here in the first quarter. Corver again way downtown, but that one clangs away. They get it back, though, to Burke. She's so tough from that range. Now she's going to be a star in the Pac-12. And nationally, that's a name to know. Kennedy Burke. Very tough in round one in the victory against Boise State. 14 points, 10 rebounds, 3 steals, and 3 blocks.
If you ask her teammates, she is a crucial, probably unsung hero, Kennedy Burke, for this team.
Katie Lou Samuelson with a short jumper, certainly for her. Here's Hayes, and it's in and out. Samuelson on the move. Her family very much involved in this tournament once again. As that one is out of play, officials will get together to determine who it is off of. With 3:54 left here in the first quarter, tied at 11, and it'll go the other way.
Well, the UCLA Bruins in hostile territory, a lot of UConn fans, but how about their countenance, their shot making? Bruins are here to play.
Well, what a journey it's been for the Samuelson family. John Samuelson, the dad of Carly, who played for Stanford last night in the Lexington Regional and got a win, liked what he saw there. Then he had to jump in the car, drive about an hour to the Cincinnati airport, and get on an early flight this morning at 4 a.m. to Charlotte. He connected through, finally got here to Bridgeport, was able to see Katie Lou Samuelson, who's on the floor for UConn. And now here he is sitting in the stands. I'm exhausted for him, but he said he got a lot of Dunkin' Donuts on the way.
Oh, that's the way to go. You're going to run into a Dunkin' on every street corner here. Holly, is he driving back to Lexington?
Yes, he probably will drive back to Lexington because Stanford won, if he can stay awake.
Samuelson off target, but draws the foul. That's where Dunkin' really helps.
I wouldn't know anything about how Dunkin' helps, Parker. But that's first world problems, isn't it? I mean, they have to get back and forth. How great is that? The Samuelson family, of course, the oldest sister, Bonnie, played for Stanford, played for Tar Vanderbilt as well, made it to a Final Four, and, of course, the youngest, Katie Lou, right here, the best player of the Samuelson sisters.
How about 19th Elite Eight for Tara Vanderveer at Stanford? And Katie Lou told us earlier in the tournament that she was asked who you'd like to play at a Final Four. She said, I wouldn't mind playing Stanford.
Yeah. Bragging rights at stake. Forget about semifinal.
Be careful what you wish for, though. This is Tara's time of year. UConn on top 13-11. So they have surged from an early deficit. Trying to get it inside for Billings. Oh, you see that athleticism, a misfire and close, and a foul with 3:10 to go. And that'll go against the Bruins.
Incredible foot speed. And Monique Billings has put in time and work to become a better basketball player because she used to travel a ton early in her career.
Corver picks up the personal. UConn has won 156 of their last 157 games. And the one they lost came on the road in overtime to Stanford in 2014. Couple of bounces, and they're working on a 157 game winning streak. That one absolutely drained from three, and now UConn is starting to look like UConn. Another theft here by Williams. It's like a light goes on. Big scramble for it. Boy, Canada was really fighting. Billings bats it back. Samuelson got it free.
Violation. I was waiting for that violation.
10 seconds. Well, it took forever. Give the Bruins all sorts of credit for hustle.
Well, you and I have talked about this in the past. There was a long stretch of time in women's college basketball where the 10-second rule was not in place. And to me, this is the exact case why you want it in play. what's happening in women's basketball, athleticism is increasingly dictating the outcome of games. So let's give these women a chance to showcase that.
I think rules changes are ahead in the women's game.
I agree.
Like going to quarters, which I thought was a great idea. The men, for some reason, a little bit reluctant to go there. Round the back, Burke, but missing.
I'll tell you the other rule, and NBA coaches keep saying, please keep saying it. The women can advance late game situation on timeouts. NBA coaches would love to see men's college basketball go do the same exact thing. So you hope those men's rules change at some point.
I think it's had a giant positive effect. And strategically, how coaches use timeouts in particular. Off Samuelson, off her fingertips and out of play. And coming up on ESPN, 4 o'clock, number 12, Quinnipiac against number 1, South Carolina. Then at 6 p.m., it's Florida State, number 3, against number 2, Oregon State. Now, we already have Oregon, of course, into the Elite Eight after a marvelous performance today.
South Carolina having to play differently, Kara, without
Elena Cole.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Do you like how they're having to play now with Asia Wilson having a little bit more room to run, so to speak?
Well, you know, I think South Carolina and Notre Dame, as we see Kia Nurse nail down that three, and here comes one of those runs, right, Danger, like the timeout here by Corey Close, because what you can't do is allow this game to get away from you. And I think both South Carolina and Notre Dame losing their starting centers. Remember, Breonna Turner lost for Notre Dame. I think they're a little bit more unpredictable offensively now, more spacing, but certainly on the defensive end, I think it hurts both teams.
Notre Dame winning 99-76 over Ohio State.
UConn winners of 109 straight games, a 17-2 here to take control of this thing.
Well, this is how they've done it over the years. I just have to say that I marvel at the grace with which the Connecticut Huskies have absorbed the weight of the legacy of the program, as you see the longest winning streaks in Division I sports history, regardless of gender. Obviously, the Miami men's tennis team, 137. But you think about the losses. Geno's team gives up the top three picks in the WNBA draft. Breanna Stewart, four up, four down for national championships. Mariah Jefferson was at the controls of this team for so long. The willingness and the growth, mentally and physically, of Samuelson, Collier, and Williams, to me, really special.
Billings, nice soft touch after a difficult catch. She averages 17-10. Gets to the line a lot. That's a big part of the Bruin attack, 4 points early. For Monique Billings. The Huskies are hitting their threes. Williams off a marvelous fake. No. And a tie up on the play. The possession arrow will keep it on this end. It'll be a UConn ball. Morgan Tuck there, one of the great, great UConn Huskies, part of the championship runs. They're so well supported by the former stars, particularly when they're here in Connecticut.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen, those of you that have seen the HBO special, I mean, you see clips of Sue Bird working out or Bria Hartley working out. Very attached, the alumni, to the program, to the success of the program, take great pride in it.
She was one of those top three picks.
Korver with her second foul. Back for Samuelson. Baseline kick, Chong for Nurse, and it's out of play, off Nurse. 19-13 Huskies.
I wasn't sure you catching up, but you were going to overhead it. Or was that just yesterday?
Hey, listen, all I know is I'm the only one intrepid enough to put myself out there. You're like talking about I'm going to get a backache. I want to go, I got a decade on you, my friend. Come at me.
I don't know after watching that if you'd be bragging. I really don't. I
mean, are you kidding me?
It never made it
did
to
you,
the circuit.
Did you step up and do it, Mr. O'Brien?
I did not.
No,
I,
you want to know part of it.
My chiropractor is busy enough.
Yes. Okay.
Final seconds here, the first quarter. Canada can't penetrate. Down to three on the shot clock. That won't drop by Cornette, and a whistle. Foul against UCLA.
So one thing you always think about is when it gets chaotic or when things start to get away from you as a basketball team, who takes ownership, right? And we were talking to Corey Close yesterday about leadership for her basketball team. Jordan Canada is their best player and their point guard. And I don't necessarily think you need volume to be a great leader, but at these moments, Kara, and you've been in these types of situations, somebody's got to collect the unit and kind of pull it back together.
it's your job. It's your job as a point guard. So regardless of how you handle it, it's your job as a point guard to recognize, understand the situation, and get your team settled. And UCLA is going to go to full court action after this, where they can't even get the rebound.
Oh, what a nice play there by Collier, who says, I'm a worker, I'm not flashy. 20 points, 9 rebounds. That's the end of the first quarter. UConn actually got off to a choppy start. So did my partner yesterday, trying that long heave. Oh, it almost made it to the circle.
Welcome back to Bridgeport here with UCLA coach Corey Close. And coach, you got off to a great start, 9-2 to start this game, but then things got away. What did you tell them in that last timeout to get regrouped?
Well, I obviously didn't tell them enough. We got to rebound the ball. They're scoring really off of our turnovers or off of missed shots. If we don't rebound the ball, we just give them too many opportunities. I feel like we're getting good shots. We're not making them, but we're getting the right kinds of shots. But we've got to rebound the basketball, especially off of free throw situations.
Thank you, coach.
You bet.
All right, they want to stay, right? But they got to get into the next round, and the winner will take on Oregon. And that is Mark Campbell, the assistant coach at Oregon, who has just a little passion about this idea of staying put and playing here.
Hey guys, I got to hug you, man.
And we drew the line. We drew the line again. Someone was going home, and it was us or them. And...
Coach Kelly Graves, the head coach. Well, that was before. Now he's in scouting mode. clearly loving every minute of this magical run for Oregon. The number 10 seed, 3 straight upsets in this tournament. The spin inside by Canada.
That's a special, Dave. Come on now. That's a special move.
22-15. She has 4 points and 3 assists. And the Bruins really need to turn to her to light it up. Downstairs. Oh, look at Williams again with a catch out of the double team. Collier's open. Got it. American Conference Cold Player of the Year with Katie Lou Samuelson. UConn 53% from the field for the year, 40% from three, almost 80% at the foul line. It's just about perfect. Hand off for Canada. Shot clock to 5 for the Bruins. She'll launch it. Williams beating everyone for the rebound.
Just incredible how much she gets off her feet and how quickly.
Canada came around and interrupted that pass. 5 turnovers for the Huskies. So times have been a little sloppy here early. UCLA with wins over the 13 seed Boise State and the 5 seed Texas A&M. That was back home at Pauley Pavilion to work their way here to Bridgeport, Connecticut. They're a team that does not typically turn it over, only about 12 times a game. Williams again for 2. The All-America candidate, the Player of the Year candidate. And so many times, Kara, just looks like she can do whatever she wants.
Well, they put so much pressure on you because Gabby Williams, by position, plays center. Well, how about your center sprinting in the full court, giving a little in-and-out dribble, and then finishing?
And oh, by the way, your center is your leading assist person and steals person.
Samuelson, yeah, all net from three-point land. Her dad used to make her take 500 shots a day. Sometimes it had to be 500 makes a day in order to get out of the gym. But what a shooter. And she's become so much more than that for the Huskies. They open up a 29-15 lead. Canada trying to cut in, looking to make a pass, and a reach and a foul on the play. Frozen 4 in Chicago fills in its final 2 spots tomorrow in men's ice hockey. The doubleheader, 3:30 and 6 o'clock at ESPNU. And watch ESPN and visit NCAA.com. It's the home for all 90 NCAA championships. Foul on Kian Nurse will be your first. So Nurse goes to the bench. Chong back on. Dangerfield also in there to help run the point, the 5'5 freshman. Here's Canada, 5'6 junior from Los Angeles. Burke again. Shot clock becoming a factor. Here's the launch. All net by Hayes. Part of UCLA's vaunted junior class. It was the number one class in the country when they came in together. Here they are with a chance to upend UConn. And a whistle, 6:55 on the clock here in the second quarter. That'll be on Kelly Hayes out of San Jose. And we're talking about Corey Close, her sixth year with the Bruins. She says she bonded with the late legend John Wooden when she started at UCLA over Corey's name, which is shared with Wooden's great granddaughter.
Okay, so if you're going to concede that shot to Gabby Williams, which you are, you still have to pressure her enough that she can't make that backdoor pass. My goodness gracious, defense has got to be better in that instance.
Dangerfield, quick step to her right, and a foul too. She'll be going to the line. Boy, that was sweet.
This happens so fast.
And from so many different people. You have Gabby Williams directing traffic, throws a dime to Kaden Samuelson, and then the freshman, Crystal Dangerfield, in transition. Just too quick. Nice little hesitation.
Throw that crossover, freshman. Just give me the cross.
She's the first recruit from the state of Tennessee to sign with Gina Auriemma.
You know, we were talking about the five players who have over 100 assists for Connecticut. It is the other rare thing about it is the assist to turnover ratio for the team. They are 2-1 as a team. You know how rare that is at any level of basketball? That from all five positions, everybody is outstanding with the basketball.
Inside again, and it's Williams fired up. And the lead balloons to 35-18 for UConn. It took them a little while, but the Huskies are in gear in Bridgeport.
Coming up on the Northwestern Mutual Halftime Report, Maria, Rebecca, and Coach Landers, we are going to talk about Oregon taking down Maryland and preview South Carolina and Quinnipiac, but here against UCLA.
Well, first, one of my favorite things to do in studio is listen to the announcers during the break. Dave, Kara is right. It's Quinnipiac.
Okay. Penultimate syllable.
Well, we saw how fast Connecticut can turn things around. Mm-hmm. They came out of the gate not shooting well, not any longer. They're on fire.
All right, Dave, turn around that pronunciation. Quinnipiac.
Quinnipiac is correct, and Rebecca doesn't make a three-quarter court shot. Figure those things out.
The bet is on, Rebecca.
She does not touch the rim.
Thank you. The most important part of that conversation was that Kara is right. Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you.
And there's no warm-up allowed for 5-0. None.
Well, no one else got one, and neither did any of the guys who tried it from the soccer team yesterday. 37-18, UConn locked in again here in Bridgeport. Trying to go on to the Elite Eight once again. Two wins here, and UConn would head to their 10th consecutive Final Four. And Canada bumped on the play and fouled there by Collier. Back to that back door.
Well, watch the tell by this young lady right here, Gabby Williams. If you're these three defenders, she's going to tell you what is about to happen. Please go back door. So how does that get through there? You got to be kidding me.
After pointing to her.
It's not that easy, though. Like, her, that's why you throw bounce passes with post players, because they can't reach down to the floor.
Okay, so, but somebody on, okay, so you're telling me that the player is pointing out what's going to happen. That's like, yes, a quarterback. I'm coming to you, my receiver. There, to me, has to be greater activity.
I think great offense can beat great defense.
I
so
agree
that was
that.
A dime that she threw.
That's,
I thought,
like,
Canada was there.
It's like running the trap in football. Great offense, yeah, will beat great defense.
Bounce into the lane. Billings with a touch. Difficult angle, but knocks it in for two. So UCLA down 17. Our own Sean Farnham addressed the UCLA Bruins before the game, trying to get them pumped up for this. They like they needed any help against the Huskies. Here's Williams in and out. Gabby averaging 14 points, 8 rebounds, 3 steals, 5 assists per game, and was not even the player of the year in her own conference. Two teammates split that award for the Huskies. Canada giving it up for Hursler, but off the back of the iron, they'll get a second effort.
honest with you, Dave, to your point just there, could you pick a most valuable player amongst the big three from UConn?
It's brutally tough. Samuelson, I would say this, in the big games that she showed up in, and we had a lot of them on ESPN, Williams was far and away the best player in those contests. She grabs another rebound.
I would have Williams as the most valuable player on the team. And there's another layer to that, her leadership component, her communication. I mean, we saw that in that backdoor play. I think she's the rare player that is helping set the tone on the offensive end and the defensive end from a post position. That's not easy to do.
And yet she's not on the finalist list for the National Player of the Year. The two names from the Connecticut Huskies, Nafisa Collier and Katie Lou Samuelson.
And let's go to Holly Rowe for more on that.
Well, Gabby Williams is the leader of this team. When the Nor'easter came through and shut down everything here in the Northeast last week, the practices were almost canceled because the UConn coaches were snowed in, couldn't get to the facility. But the players walked in the blizzard. Gabby Williams said, "I was up all night coming up with a practice plan. I had about an hour put together that I wanted to run through with our players." So how about that? Gabby Williams, in the absence of the coaches, stepping up to lead the practice to make sure they were still productive on a Nor'easter snowing day.
From all reports, not just a simple walkthrough. They went after it for a good hard hour. Billings slamming on the brakes. And she's been a bright spot for UCLA.
Athletically, she is so fast, like Gabby Williams. Vertically, just special. Speed, special.
And Billings with eight. It has not been enough, though, against these Huskies so far, trying to go to 35-0. Dangerfield way downtown and air-mailed it. And a foul as Nurse hit the deck. And tonight at 11 Eastern on ESPN, catch SportsCenter at Night with Chris and Lisa. They break down the men's and women's NCAA tournament, plus the NBA, spring training, NHL, NFL, and more. SportsCenter at Night, also streaming live on the ESPN app.
There's our boy, Sean Farnham. UCLA's, one of UCLA's finest. You know what I love most about Gabby Williams? Two things. As Nafisa Collier makes that layup. One, she plays herself to exhaustion. I mean, we've seen that in the big games you talked about. In that Notre Dame game, she played herself to exhaustion. And the second thing is her brain still works when she plays herself to exhaustion. And that doesn't happen for everybody. I mean, some people's brain doesn't work on the court when they're not tired. But hers still does, and she's able to lead and be able to do that. I mean, that is hard to do when you play yourself to that point, almost to that breaking point physically, and you're still able to be engaged mentally.
It's rare to see her tired. Like, her endurance is special.
Yep, it's a great motor on the 5'11 junior from Nevada and a two-time Olympic gold medal winner as well. Coming up on the two-minute mark. 40-22 UConn. And a misfire in close, an 18-point lead. Dangerfield. That's a shifty pass. And Collier for two. Now it's up to 20. Korver got it. That's a fast answer for UCLA.
Wow. And all four she's attempted, three of them have been two or three steps behind the arc.
Big answer by Collier. Now, that's another thing she can do. 42% out there. Not a lot of attempts, only 43 attempts.
She's just a bucket getter. I mean, she catches everything and she finishes everything. You want to talk about a complete offensive player. And Nafisa Collier's right there. How about Korver?
Wow, I'm telling you. These are not from, you know, toeing on the line. These are two or three steps, every one of them, from deep. She's trying to shoot this team back into it.
They're 4 out of 10 outside the line. Samuelson becoming a three-point shooting show. Give her 14. And a Katie Lou chance. The Lou chance start from the UConn faithful. UConn really in their comfort zone here with under 40 seconds before the half. Korver looking for Canada. UConn on near a 100-point pace. Hursler drains it. Another triple. The shooting's been impressive. UConn's had more makes. Time for another shot here by the Huskies. Dangerfield flips it up. That didn't touch a thing. Out it goes back over to the Bruins. They have time to heave one up there.
You got time for a little bit more than that, Dave. With the speed of Jordan Canada, she's trying to say to everybody, inbound this, and wisely, Kia Nurse is going to push up. You'd ideally like Korver to catch this thing because she's got a lot less speed.
And the guard trying to get toward midcourt, knocked out of play.
You had to extend because 3.3 for Jordan Canada, that's at least two dribbles for her.
From midcourt, she'll heave it up there and got there, but could not make it. And UConn has the lead. And they have it by plenty, 48 to 31. We're going to try and get Gabby with us here. The outstanding junior will be joined by Holly Rowe in just a moment. At the break, UConn leading 48 to 31. Let's go to Holly.
Well, Gabby, UCLA jumped out to a 9-2 lead. Why did it take a little time for you guys to get rolling there?
You know, they came out really aggressive, and I think we should have prepared for that. I think we did a better job kind of slowing down Canada and keeping her out of the lane, but we just have to do better perimeter defense.
Perimeter defense is the key. They can shoot themselves back into this. So what do you do to stop those threes?
We just got to run them off the line. You know, we'll take a contested two over a three any day. So we just got to get them off the line and have our big guys help.
Thank you.
Yep.
Gabby and Holly, thank you very much. As we send it back to Maria Taylor, Rebecca Lobo, and Andy Landers in the studio, UConn up big at halftime here in Bridgeport. And welcome back to the NCAA Women's Championship presented by Capital One, the regional semifinals for Bridgeport, Connecticut. A surge by the UConn Huskies to take a 48-31 lead over UCLA at the break. Dave O'Brien alongside Kara Lawson and Doris Burke and Holly Rowe. And guys, how does UCLA crawl back into this thing in the second half?
I think it starts defensively. I mean, they're going to have to get a handle on what UConn is doing on that floor. Easier said than done. But UConn is a team, 48 points in the first half. I mean, you can't give them another half like that and expect to win the game.
UConn won that first half exactly how they've won all year. 28 points between Katie Liu and Nafisa, and the box score being filled up by this young woman. How about 8 points, 4 assists, and 6 rebounds by Gabby Williams? There's not a player in college basketball who's doing more to affect winning in more areas than Gabby Williams.
Another one for you. UConn in the first half committed all of 3 fouls. UCLA never got to the foul line. Samuelson with it. Taken away by Burke with the quick hands. And the Bruins trying to get on the board quickly here in the second half. They hit some threes in the tail end of the second quarter. Korver came up with 9 points. So she led all scorers for the Bruins. Canada had 7 assists, so some nice individual numbers for UCLA. But from a team perspective, it's straight uphill. Turnaround by Billings, that won't drop. Let's bring in Holly Rowe now, who is with Miss Korver in the tail end of that halftime.
Well, we talked a lot about UConn going on these runs. How were you able to withstand that, fight back when you looked for threes towards the end?
I think just I was open, so I took the shots, but we have to do a better job taking away them in transition and getting rebounds so they don't get second chance points.
What belief is there in this group that you can come back in this game?
Oh, there's tons of belief. We can do it. We just know we have to take away their transition game, we have to rebound like I just said. That's what we talked about at halftime. If we do that, we're in this game.
You've got some threes in your pocket. I feel it.
Yeah, I hope so. Thanks, Holly.
Holly, thank you very much. Canada with it here. We'll lift the mid-range and knock it in. Give her 6 points. Gino Auriemma on the line today would be his 990th career victory. So 1,000 under any circumstances is going to wait till next season, 2017-18. And is out of play. Will stay here with 8:19 to go in the quarter.
Would also tie the great Pat Summitt for NCAA tournament victory should Gino Auriemma win today. And then, of course, he has already got the highest winning percentage overall in women's college basketball history. He had to take over the great Leon Barmore for that.
Williams in tight with a misfire. Canada looking to breathe life into the Bruin offensive attack, and she can do it on plays like that.
She was 2-for-10 in the first half. She's certainly going to have to shoot a higher percentage, but you've gotten glimpses right into her level of ability. Special in the open floor, able to make difficult shots near the rim.
Did some explosive games, 6-25 or more games. Oh. Williams blows by everyone, draws the foul. She will be at the line again.
Saw that coming, didn't you? I mean, it's just, once you go for a fake or go for something with Gabby Williams, I mean, it's lights out. You're not going to have the closing speed. Billings actually does a pretty good job to contest that shot, but the athleticism and the explosiveness of Williams there on full display.
One of the things about Gabby Williams that we were giggling about yesterday in meeting with some of the Huskies, she said, well, Gino called me a center the other day. I guess that makes me a center. But a center who also leads the team in passing and a bunch of other categories. File 734 remaining.
83 steals, 231 assists. And really, Gabby Williams has had a truly special year in college basketball and can't even make the finalist list for player of the year. I frankly don't understand it.
Yeah, that's rather silly. Way downtown, and that'll be knocked in by Cornette. With 21 in a game earlier this season at Arizona, so she can score. Samuelson knocked around in the lane, no whistle there. No foul. Gino is up, he's upset. Cornette off the back of the iron. Canada went down hard on the foul. On her back. We'll see if Jordan Canada, the All-American candidate, is okay. Slow to rise, but up. Fouled by Kia Nurse.
Oh. Right on her lower back, it looked like. I love UCLA, the way they're playing here. Possessions, they've gotten some quality looks.
Cornette thinking about a jumper. Got it into Billings. Back for Cornette.
I love the activity of the Connecticut defense. Multiple effort.
Doesn't that get lost in the shuffle sometimes?
As pretty as they are on the offensive end, they've built this national championship program on the strength of being the best defense in the country.
Pass never got to Billings, tipped with three on the shot clock, and Samuelson has it. Chong is the open shooter. Got it for three.
Every time you make a mistake or you leave someone loose, they make you pay because they have all five players that are a threat to score. Chong, you would say, maybe the least of your worries in terms of an offensive threat, but she has the ability to knock down the three-point shot.
Canada drawing the contact. Boy, she's taking some hits here in the second half. Through the foul by Nurse, and for Kia Nurse, number three.
I think Chong may be the probably undertold part of this story. Shania Chong, in the history of her career, has never played this well, this late, on this important a role in her career. And she said the one goal she had this season was to be consistent. Mission accomplished to this point. And Gino has said of Shania Chong, if she plays this well, we're going to be very tough to beat.
Coverage of the men's basketball championship. The regional finals continues tonight on TBS at 6 at Xavier and Gonzaga. Can Mark Few get to the Final Four at last? For more information on game times and listings, go to NCAA.com.
I mean, think about this. How often do we see players that don't have an impact their freshman year and then their sophomore year, maybe they have a little bit more junior year, maybe their first two seasons, they don't get any run. 3 years. I mean, there was barely a heartbeat to her game. She wasn't able to get in. She didn't play any meaningful minutes in three seasons. And now all of a sudden, she's playing all the time in every single big game.
So something clicked. Something happened. What do you think it was?
Well, I think part of it was necessity. They had to have her play. And I think the more she played, the more confidence she gained.
She had moments where she impacted you and I. A year ago, December, we're in New York for the Jimmy V game between Maryland. She shut the door on them, did the same thing this year at Maryland. So there were brief glimpses of maybe big shot making. But Dave, they don't walk out of Florida State. They don't walk out of Tallahassee with a win unless this kid makes shots.
Well, a miss for her there, but a second effort thanks to Collier. Here's Williams down the lane. Another lay-in for Gabby Williams, who has 12. 5:16 remaining. Let's go to more on Sanaya Chong, the 5'8 senior.
Well, so how do you keep this streak alive? Sometimes unexpected contributions. This is on the road to Florida State, and this young woman has a timely way of making important plays. Maryland was putting all kinds of game pressure in the Xfinity Center. That three closed the door. So what contributes to a streak? Big moments by big-time players, and this young woman, how about the consistency of this season? Look at that comparison. Last season, just to this, minutes, points, assists, everything.
Let's bring in Holly.
Well, Gino Arama would always remind us that she was a prolific scorer in high school. She gets to UConn, and she just can't beat out Mariah Jefferson. He said, I felt at one point that she just resigned herself, that I'm not going to get into the lineup. But when the chance came this summer, she was ready. A lot of people thought Crystal Dangerfield would take her spot, and Sanaya did not allow it to happen. She said, because my teammates started to trust me, knew I had the skill, I started trusting myself, and that showed up on the floor.
I was one of those people that thought Crystal Dangerfield was going to come in and take her spot because I hadn't seen enough of the consistency from Sanaya. You know, credit her, because it is very difficult to do what she did, which is change your frame of mind and be able to be a viable part of this team. Not easy to do at a place like UConn.
Dangerfield, a terrific pass leading to an and one for Gabby Williams when we come back to Bridgeport.
The games are here. The goal is clear. You want to win it all? The NCAA Women's Tournament.
And today on ESPNW.com, among the stories, Lauren Cox juggling type 1 diabetes at Baylor. And quite a struggle. But Baylor, no struggle last night.
Oh. How good have they looked in this NCAA tournament to this point? I mean, they've been the second best team in the tournament, in my opinion.
Now, many were saying that there were a handful of teams that had a shot at UConn. One of them, Maryland, well, they're out now.
Yeah.
And the other, maybe at the very top of the list, the Baylor Bears, Lady Bears, who gave them a tough game earlier this season, which got away a little bit late in Gino Auriemma's favor. But many are anticipating that kind of a matchup. We shall see. UCLA down by 20.
The biggest concern, I thought, coming into the tournament in terms of health, other than Elena Coates, who's now ruled out, was Alexis Jones, the electric dynamic point guard for Baylor. But you combine her with the size that they have on the interior. Nina Davis went for 21 in their last game, so perhaps she's back into the scoring column at a high rate. There's a lot of different answers. You've got a tremendous freshman class. And I'll tell you, that's going to be a really cool story about Lauren Cox managing diabetes. I remember covering Adam Morrison when he was at Gonzaga and literally doing a sideline report on, I watched him inject himself with insulin live at Madison Square Garden at one point. It's a little different for Lauren Cox. You know, the technology obviously has come such a long way. She's got sort of an automatic, I don't want to say drip, but it's just a little bit easier situation. Still, I mean, can you imagine Division I athlete at that level dealing with that?
It's amazing to me that they can maintain and still play at such a high level. The foul bringing howls from the crowd here with 3:27 to go in the third. Foul will go on Collier, her second. A little bit of a grin there from Gino. What do you think?
Well, the right arm did go down. It didn't stay vertical, so I'm assuming that that's what the reasoning was.
Putting Billings at the line. We set a UCLA record for foul shots in a season this year.
I would say I'm going to comment on the officials only if it's within 10.
Okay.
It's a new rule I'm instituting for myself.
Self-imposed
restriction.
The restraint of the, who are you?
Well, I am an outstanding official when get multiple looks and super slow-mo opportunities. Excellent. Put a whistle in my hands.
60-43, the Huskies. Dangerfield. Another nice bounce pass. She's had some great looks today.
Come on now. She, listen, I don't want to talk sacrilege here, but the great Mariah Jefferson was not the passer that this young woman was as a freshman. And think about the career Mariah Jefferson went on to have.
Kenna slinging the pass for Cornette. She was open. Dangerfield kind of got took down there. Canada with it on the baseline. Here's Billings to the paint and banks it in.
I just like the way UCLA has played, to echo Kara's point. Now, obviously, UConn is in complete control. But if you're talking about a program that's trying to build, as Corey Close is, you play hard regardless of score. Are you down double digits? You're down big? Yes. But there should be some pride with the UCLA across the front of your chest.
And their program on the rise, and they'll play just about anybody, won't they? They took on number 2 Baylor, number 6 South Carolina. They lost both of those on the road, but solid wins over Stanford, Oregon State, Washington, and a brutal Pac-12 as Samuelson is on target.
You can't duck people. I mean, if you're going to be a legitimate program, you can't duck people.
We talk about this all the time as it relates to the national championship race, because UConn is the big piece in the national championship race. Exposure to greatness and to great teams only helps expedite your process, only helps expedite your players' learning curves, and helps you improve.
UCLA is scheduled to play at UConn next season.
You wonder if this gets much closer to, is Gino Auriemma using timeout, or he's going to let his players play through this. But this is right there. You talk about 12 points.
On a 7-0 run for the Bruins. It was 20 not long ago. Holly will be speaking with Coach Auriemma at the end of this quarter. Off the fake, Collier back for Chong's three. Burying it.
They don't get sped up. How about Collier at that free throw line area? Just the patience. Well, one more pass. Offensively, Dave, just, it's a thing of beauty.
Precision offense by the Huskies. 34-0, they've won 109 straight as Canada drains the jumper. Inside the last minute of the third quarter, look at that margin of victory at over 38 points per win. This one right now at 13, UCLA still in the game. Dangerfield a near turnover, now tie up on the play. And a possession arrow will belong to UCLA. Canada's down again. She spent a lot of the time here in the third quarter on the deck. And they've gotten physical with her. Madison Square Garden will host the NIT's Final Four. TCU and Central Florida in tonight's second semifinal, Tuesday at 9 at ESPN. And visit NCAA.com, the home for all 90 NCAA championships.
Two guys who have done a tremendous job coaching. Johnny Dawkins has got 7'6" Taco Fall in his lineup, and Jamie Dixon, of course, the success he had at Pittsburgh, he brings that to TCU. Both teams were sort of bubblicious briefly, now getting to New York.
This was the year of the soft bubble.
Yes.
8 to get off a shot. Canada, by the way, has broken the UCLA career assist record so far this afternoon, dishing them out. Here's Williams, got it up for Samuelson, did not get it off in time, so that's not going to count. Even though she banked it in, it'll be no basket. It was after the horn.
At the end of the quarter, UConn 65.
So at the end of three, UConn on top, 65-52. Set for the fourth quarter in Bridgeport. And the Huskies closing in on an Elite Eight appearance.
Here with UConn coach Gino Auriemma. This UCLA squad is feisty. They're not going away. What concerns you the most about their ability to score and close this gap?
Well, they're really athletic, as you can say, you can see. So we've got some bad matchups out there. We got to do a better job of keeping them out of the lane. And they rebound the hell out of the ball. We did a great job rebounding it in the first half, but we got to keep scoring. You know, at this time of the year, everybody's good. So we got to keep scoring. That's the best answer I could give you.
That's brilliant. Thank you.
And they do it oh so well. They are hitting 58% from the field and out-rebounding UCLA 31-20. So you look at this, most NCAA tournament wins by a head coach, men's and women's, and Gino can tie the great Pat Summitt with a victory here today.
Can I just say how much I miss the presence of Pat Summitt? She was a towering figure in the game, always so gracious every time we went in there, knew everything we needed to have as a broadcast team. You just miss her presence, period.
O'Kara had the great honor and privilege of playing for Pat Summitt, a giant figure in basketball. Chong with a blow by and lays it in. But you're right, this time of the year, not to be around Pat. And Tennessee has done some great stuff under Holly Warlick. Three Elite Eights, just recently knocked out of the tournament. And Pat Summitt just one in a billion.
Yeah, I miss her every day, you guys. I miss her every single day. And the game, you know, the game misses her presence, as you spoke of, because of how much of her time and her energy she gave to the sport.
And what a difference she made in so many lives.
Imagine Holly Warlick trying to take over for your mentor, your best friend, in a program where the last leader not only was an icon in your sport, but changed the lives of women. She changed the way competitive sports were viewed on the discav side.
Nurse with a kick out for Williams. Shot clock down to 8. Hasn't gotten that low very many times for the Huskies today. Samuelson with a nice pass in tight and a whistle. Let's go to Holly Roll.
Well, this UCLA Bruin team is not giving up. Sticking my head in their huddles, there is a ton of fight left in this team. Corey Close letting her team know that the key to this fourth quarter, down 15 right now, is the hustle plays, that they have got to get some extra possessions, rebounding. And then she wants to see more tempo from their offense. They've got to get some pace going, try to get this UConn team out of position with a quicker defense, or excuse me, a quicker offense that they are so good at.
Now, Holly makes it sound aggressive, sticking my head in there. No one is more welcome sticking their head in the huddle than Holly Rowe. 69-52. Canada baseline. Shut down, a nice reverse up there.
Well, the point that Holly speaks of is well taken, because you're down 15 points. And so, yes, you do need to speed it up, because you need as many possessions left in this game as possible to give yourself a chance to win it.
UCLA was clean in the third, weren't they? They did not commit a turnover in the third quarter. John, terrific fake, finds the open shooter and knocked in by Collier.
That whole thing, though, was set up by the ball fake she made at the start of the catch.
Billings, a lot of white shirts around, may have forced that shot. Boy, Williams did a great job to flick that pass with that save off of UCLA to get it back to the Huskies. So still playing at such a high octane level. At about 8 minutes remaining in Bridgeport, the winner gets Oregon, the Cinderella here in Bridgeport. The Ducks continue to hang around and knock off higher seeds. They've done it 3 times already. They've been a magical story. Here's Samuelson, can't bury it. Cornette finds a lane. That's going to be an offensive. Her second foul.
Well, if Mr. Samuelson is going to start the drive back, at what point maybe does he feel comfortable that the lead is good enough as you take a second look at the charge? Or excuse me, not the charge, Billings with an illegal screen.
Yeah,
I think Billings was saying, I was posting up.
Yeah.
That's why I was kind of looking at you like, really? Hey, you said if it was over 10 points, you weren't going to comment.
Hey, listen, newbie, settle back.
It's a work in progress.
Okay, all right.
This can't all be expected at once.
I got you. I'm just trying to hold you accountable, DB.
Yeah,
it's
like
all love.
You're our INS goal.
No basket there, the foul before that.
It's a temptation I find very hard. It's like Lent, you know, I always fall off the wagon in Lent. Fell off the wagon.
And our monitors are right here.
I mean,
we're great with these monitors in the super slow-mo. And John Madry to our left, to my left, who does such a great job on our stats. And another jump shot buried by Collier.
You know, in all fairness, I did kind of tease her with my comment.
You did. You baited me into that. You're supposed to be my teammate.
Canada with the step through. Well, Holly, we're debating, you know, what's going to happen with Mr. Samuelson now? When does he feel like it's okay to watch another daughter in the NCAA tournament and leave this arena?
Well, I think he is going to go catch a flight out of Hartford. He's got another drive on his hands. He's going to have to drive all the way to Hartford tonight to catch another flight, go back that same routing through Charlotte to Cincinnati, and then drive another hour on the other end to get back to Lexington. I am so impressed with this dad. He might have had his daughters taking 500 shots a day, but he's putting in the equal amount of work for this very unique. Look at this. There's the win last night in Lexington from Carly with Stanford. 2:30 a.m. he's sleeping in the airport. And then 4 a.m. getting ready for his flight. He's got a little Dunkin' Donuts there, Windsor Locks, Connecticut. And then he had a cute picture there at the end with Katie Lou Samuelson. We just ran out of time.
Okay, can we do this for this man? Can we do this for this man? In special circumstances, airlines give people all kinds of deals.
Yeah.
Somebody, Southwest Airlines, American Airlines, United, step up for the Samuelson family. Give this guy a break.
I think with all the love that he's giving Dunkin' Donuts, D&D may want to step up and spring for the ticket. But he's terrific. And you know his daughters are loving every minute of a glorious experience, but he's along for the ride, and he was such an active part in their development as great player. Another three-pointer going down here. UCLA has hit some of those today. To hang around, they've hit eight. Although they've taken 21. 5:45 remaining here in the fourth. Nurse with it. Nurse tiptoes in. Bounce feed. Hayes denied there by Collier. Onto the floor and a tie-up. Possession now belongs to UCLA.
Boy, that's how you come with a double, though, right? If you're going to come in on a double, you come with very high hands. You come with authority, as Nafisa Collier did.
Corbin to check it in. Over the top for Canada. Point guard has scored over 1,500 points in her UCLA career. Samuelson guarding Canada. And it's a foul on Katie Lou. And the partisan UConn crowd does not like the call. That'll be her first of the day, however. John is starting to get some messages on the phone. Maybe from an executive at an airline.
That would be good.
Let's hope. He's done extremely well to make it to two cities already for his daughters. Canada directing traffic. The junior from Los Angeles who stayed home. Shot clock inside 10 seconds. Here's Hayes. She can't nail it. Rebound tip to Burke. Back up. No. Once again, that pogo stick known as Gabby Williams jumping in for another rebound. 76-59, UConn comfortably in front.
The NCAA Women's Championship is presented by the Quicksilver Card from Capital One. Earn unlimited 1.5% cash back every purchase, everywhere.
We take a look at our Capital One Cup Impact Performance. UConn's Nafisa Collier, sometimes she does things so efficiently and quietly, it gets by you. But 24 points, 13 rebounds, 5 assists, and 3 blocks, and almost 5 minutes yet to play.
I mean, incredible performance, and she's made the incredible performances seem mundane a little bit with how easy it is for her and her efficiency. But what a year she's had. I mean, and you know, she's a little quiet. I mean, we had him in the meetings yesterday, and she doesn't talk a ton, but she is such a good teammate and a key cog for this team.
Yep, she said, I'm a worker, I'm not flashy.
How about that catch?
Got it back outside for Samuelson, a determined drive, but not there. UCLA hoping to get a little bit closer here. Hayes with a bounce and it's kicked. Well, we've figured out a couple of things here today. First of all, number one, the correct pronunciation on Quinnipiac.
Mm-hmm. Quinnipiac.
Quinnipiac.
Yes.
And the second thing is Maria Taylor threw Rebecca Lobo totally under the bus.
Totally under the bus.
Oh, my goodness.
Totally under the bus on this long toss.
This is breaking news.
So Rebecca's off the hook. Yeah. And Maria Taylor, wear your sneakers to Dallas, my friend. You are trying the Destiny Slocum three-quarter 70-foot shot on. No warm-up, my friend. And I don't care how young you are. I want bets on who, if she touches rim or not. Maria Taylor, how are you going to do 5-0 like that?
Yeah, everybody's All-American, so I think...
You're on fire today, DB.
Yeah.
I'm ready. You're issuing challenges to everybody. I'm a little nervous.
5-0. I can't. You don't even know who you're messing with there, Maria Taylor.
I knew it was coming. There was no way around it. 3:50 to go, 76-59. That's a showdown I'm going to pay to see, those two.
I'm sitting way up in the 300s. I'm sitting up in the 300s.
Save me a seat,
yes,
please.
Yes.
Korver from the corner. Well, she hit a few early. Tough work for Billings as she gets hit. Really had a terrific year for UCLA. She broke the single season blocks record. She was 20 away from the rebounding record for UCLA today.
I tell you, I'm curious. There's a lot of kids coming back for Corey Close with another year of experience in the NCAA tournament, the Pac-12 being what we've already discussed. Jordan Canada, though, is one of those many draft-eligible juniors by age that could go early to the WNBA. So I had asked Jordan Canada earlier in the season, you know, where are you with that? And she kind of put me off a little bit. She said, I haven't even thought about that. But it's an interesting discussion for many of these draft-eligible juniors across the country.
And some of those transfers that are, you know, 4 years removed from high school. So, yeah, there's a lot of high-power programs that are waiting on decisions from players that could make themselves eligible for the draft or could stay an extra year.
Very rare turnover there, but it's 13 today for Gino's team. And he's still coaching like this is a two-point game. Leading 76-61. A win for the Huskies brings them to 35-0 and brings the winning streak to 110. Baseline drive and a foul on the Huskies. Last four seasons, UConn is 40-0, 38-1, 38-0, and now on the verge of 35-0.
Okay, can I just explain, and I'm going to try to do this without crying. I'm about to do something I never do. So my daughter is not far from here competing at Seton Hall today in a moot court environment. And I can't go. One of the things working mother struggles with. She advanced to the final at Seton Hall in the moot court.
Congratulations.
Do you think I'm fired up? Congratulations, sweetheart. You can't see me, but I love you and I'm proud of you.
That's awesome.
Going to be a great lawyer, by the way.
Yes, she is.
Going to be my lawyer one day.
If I could use the kind of language I'd like to use right now to say congratulations to my daughter, America, you'd be hearing a lot of beeps right now.
Oh, a big collision there between Chong and Canada. Canada with some nice sportsmanship to help her to her feet.
Wow, that's a dangerous collision. My goodness, this is scary for kids.
Well, she thought she was going to pass it, Canada, yeah, so she jumped to do it and then realized she still had to dribble. So it was inadvertent. By Jordan Canada, she was trying to get the pass. Mm.
Four on Canada.
You can see she goes right over to her.
So Sanaya Chong to shoot 80% at the foul line. Ranking third in the USA in assist to turnover ratio. And back to the bench will be Kelly Hayes for the Bruins. UCLA second year in a row in the Sweet 16. And barring an amazing comeback, that's where it'll end this year. Canada. Back out top for Korver. Got it from three.
Man, that girl is flat shooting the ball today. That is, I believe, number five. So does that set the UCLA record for threes?
I think it might have tied the career record at UCLA, which is phenomenal for Carrie Korver and the job she's done her entire career at UCLA.
Senior, so she has an opportunity to break the all-time record. Samuelson and another whistle. Now keep an eye on number two for the Bruins. despite whatever the final score is, because she has a career record on the line. Let's go to Holly.
Well, everybody asked me, is this Kerry Korver related to that Kyle Korver? And the answer is yes. They're first cousins. They're very close. She actually got to hang out with him in Los Angeles this week when he was there playing the Los Angeles Lakers and Clippers with the Cleveland Cavaliers. He sent her lots of texts. There's lots of love and support. But she says, I hate it when they say shooting's in the blood. No, she said, I'm a good shooter because I put in work in the gym, hard hours, and that's why she's got that Korver legacy going on.
And she's pursuing the record while trying to keep this team attached, and it's 12 right now.
And they have the ball. Gornet. And a travel. So that would have been an important possession for sure if they were going to make a run, and they turn it over. And she'll hit the bench.
Keep in mind, only three of the 109 straight wins for the Connecticut Huskies in single digits.
John will pull it back out. Is Williams, who's had another big day. None bigger than Nafisa Collier for sure, and another whistle. The 2:14 showing. Oregon awaiting the winner. A marvelous win, an upset for the Oregon Ducks today. And a game that started at 8:30 in the morning their time, Pacific time. But they looked wide awake against Maryland and beat a higher seed, a number three seed in the upset.
And I would say, you know, if it plays and Connecticut goes on and wins this on the final 2:14, some of the things that were applicable in the Maryland game in terms of scout and things would be similar. I don't think you want to get into an up and down game with the Connecticut Huskies. They're going to have to control tempo. They're going to have to create tremendous shots for themselves. They're going to have to keep their turnovers to a minimum. They're going to have to try to keep Connecticut from getting easy baskets. The formula somewhat the same.
Two more for Canada. Collier, by the way, has 26. 20 points for Jordan Canada. 80-68. Exactly 2 minutes to play. Back here in Bridgeport, UConn with the ball. UCLA trying to get a little bit tighter in this one, but time is running out on the Bruins and their season.
Going to start to aggressively jump the basketball trap. You can see they're in full court pressure man to man, but you got to create some turnovers.
What a day it's been for Nafisa Collier. Nafisa Collier with 26 points, 13 rebounds. Now, before the game, Kelly Graves, the only coach to take two double-digit seeds to the Elite Eight. He's done it again, chatting up Gino Auriemma right before this contest.
Well, great respect. There was a great quote when he was given the job at Oregon. He said, Kelly Graves is a great guy and a great coach, and I have no doubt he will be competing for Pac-12 championships before too long.
Well, now he's competing against Gino Auriemma. And the Elite Eight coming up. And for a chance to go to the Final Four, and for Oregon and the Ducks, looks like a possibility at a colossal upset. Now, that'll be 7 o'clock on Monday night. We'll have it for you. Oregon against the winner of this one. You see the other four in Stockton, California. And that'll be at 9 o'clock in Stockton on Monday. And we'll follow our game on ESPN.
You know, Florida State has always been an intriguing team to me all year, and you know, a little bit up and down towards the end of that ACC regular season, but they have tremendous talent. They have great depth. They have a terrific point guard in Leticia Romero. I think South Carolina and Oregon State, Florida State, all of them are capable of winning two games out there in Stockton and getting to a Final Four.
This is under official review, by the way. Inside the last 2 minutes, the officials are allowed to go to the monitor, and in overtime, they can do the same thing to determine if a pass has been tipped off a particular player. They can go to the monitor and figure it out.
Figure out whose possession it is. Did it double touch?
UCLA's Kelly Hayes going after it, and so is Katie Lou Samuelson of the Huskies.
The original ruling was UConn basketball.
Was UConn, yeah. I mean, you know, now Kennedy Burke seemed like she thought it was off Katie Lou, but, you know, players are so good at pretending, yeah. You don't know. But her first initial reaction, she didn't think she had touched it last.
It was hard to see on our replay.
Correct. And it has to be overwhelming evidence to the contrary of the call initially made. So unless they saw something we didn't, I think it'd be hard to overrule this. Let's see if this is a little bit more telling. So there's the first touch.
Yeah.
See, there is
that's
a second
off.
Touch. So
it's off. Yep,
this should be UCLA.
I would agree. They're huddling now off the monitor. So we'll get a ruling on this.
Official trying to get Gino Auriemma's attention.
Along with Corey Close of UCLA, Corey Close was raving about the regard she has for UConn. And, you know, Holly talked about this earlier. Obviously, every coach has great respect for the program, but Gino's willingness and generosity to invite other coaches to his practices in October and again in March, in a March UCLA wasn't playing in the tournament, to figure out how do you prep your team for the season to come and also the tournament to come. And she took full advantage of that.
I was just going to say the shot clock has switched possession, so they have to get that to 30 for UCLA.
UCLA ball. That's the eventual decision. Way downtown, Cornett. No, that missed badly. And a tie up and a foul against the Bruins with a minute 28 on the clock.
I think, one, I admire Corey Close for making use of multiple opportunities and the willingness of Gino Auriemma to share his information. I think the key is, you know, you have to be able to carry over all of those things, and that's the hard part. And Corey was talking about that. It takes incredible discipline to maintain the level of expectation daily in the Connecticut program in terms of practice and expectation that they do. It's why they have been as special as they have been. You and I have talked about this over and over, and Holly Rowe was talking about this yesterday. The speed at which Connecticut runs its practices, regardless. I mean, Holly's looking at me yesterday, Dave, and asking me, I don't think I've ever been at a program where kids are running so fast, and our observation table is about four steps, five steps, where you're feeling the wind of the Connecticut kids as they're going by the table. And Holly's looking at me like, these kids are moving at a high clip.
Yep. And it never stops, games or practices. And I got to be honest with you, that is not the case with that many programs when you watch them practice or play.
No, I mean, we have the opportunity to watch hundreds of practices over the course of a season, shoot arounds, and they are at the top in terms of organization, in terms of execution, in terms of work ethic and how hard they push themselves. And that goes across men's and women's college basketball.
Yes.
Not just the women's game.
Direct. That's correct. Billings at the line here. Solid day with 15 points. She averages 17. That one won't drop, and it's out of play off UCLA with the score 81-68.
I wonder if this other official is going to check, because it felt to me like that might have gone off the back of Gabby Williams, so I think there might be another review. Now, the crowd's upset with the stoppage of play, but they are going to look at this, and it might have gone off the back of Gabby Williams.
Well, the rule's in place to take a look. Ruling on the floor is UConn ball. Again, you're looking for evidence to overturn that call, and I didn't see it. See if we can pick up something on this angle. What do you think?
Well, I'm just wondering, on the second touch from behind by UCLA, did it graze her fingertips? But again, it's got to be disputable or indisputable. Is it indisputable or undisputable? Indisputable.
Indisputable.
Yeah.
I go indisputed, and I go Quinnipiac.
Yes, OB. Yes. Yeah.
116 remaining. And again, if the Huskies win the national championship in Dallas, it'll be an undefeated season for the third time in the last 4 years. A victory today makes the win streak 110 consecutive games.
Now, I'm telling you this, if you do not unseat them this year, the next two are going to be incredibly difficult. You're adding 6'6", Azaree Stevens, who's got unbelievable basketball skill, but Tuli Camaro, the transfer from Kentucky, and oh, by the way, the National High School Player of the Year, and Megan Walker. Look out, folks.
get UConn now or don't get them the next 2 years unless there's catastrophic injury in the program.
Will be Huskies ball here. Let's go to Holly.
Well, guys, as good as this has seemed for UConn, the margin of victory is a little closer if they hold on this last minute 16. But more important, they have not scored a field goal in 5 minutes. I think Gino's probably apoplectic right now with his inability to score a field goal.
Well, looking for a touchdown here. Williams, nice save to Nurse. That's great hustle. Boy, when your best player plays that hard all the time. Yeah, I think he'd like someone to make a shot, though, a foul against UCLA.
You know what I loved about that play? I mean, I certainly love Gabby Williams' sprint, but it was Kia Nurse's sprint so that she was there when Gabby Williams saved it, right? Like, that's the next level. That's what UConn does that other people don't do. So everyone's going to chase after the ball. Everyone's going to make that initial sprint. But are you sprinting just in case? Just in case your teammate needs you. And Kia Nurse was right there.
Canada has fouled out with 20 points.
Great use of apoplectic.
So Williams with another one coming.
The Corver back in the basketball game. Yeah. Can they get her a three so that the record is hers and hers alone?
Well, she handed off there inside a minute. And a little shove from behind, the foul maybe on Collier. 55.4 on the clock. And that's going to be number 5 on Nafisa, who had a big, big day. 27 points, a double-double for Collier. And a big hand, and man, did she earn that.
I have a feeling she'll hear about the foul out as well. He's shaking his head. Yep, there's going to be some kind of remark right there. I'd love to know what was just said.
He never stops pushing. And I think it's one of the questions that Holly Rowe's going to ask her when we get to that part right after the broadcast.
Well, she had a career high 39 at South Florida. And because he likes to challenge her about her defense, he said, yeah, well, don't worry, you gave up 30. Everybody, you guarded. So you were only plus 9 on the game despite that career high 39. And he's giving it to her.
Looking like UCLA is going to finish their season at 25-9. And for Corey Close, she said, you know, coming into this game today, that UCLA was playing their best basketball of the season. Felt very good about themselves.
I think this has been a good performance by UCLA.
Sure.
You know, when you look at them getting down as much as they did, down 17 at the half. We've seen so many times during this UConn win streak, teams roll over in the first 5 minutes of that second half. They didn't. They were able to cut into the lead. I've been impressed with their performance.
She keeps building it, doesn't she, Corey Close? Slowly but surely, methodically, piece by piece.
Hey, good luck if you play in the Pac-12 the next 3 years. Oh. I mean, what we saw from Oregon and their youth in the first game, this UCLA team with a bright future.
As Corver looking for the all-time record, but came up empty. So she had a crack at it. We'll see if she gets another one. Foul, stop on the clock, 35.4 left.
She didn't know how close she was to the record. In fact, their SID, you know, tried to keep her shielded because she didn't want to know. So we spilled the beans where we really shouldn't have.
Yeah, we being me, unfortunately. Chong to the line. One thing, you know, with Holly's proximity to the UCLA bench, she's telling us the coaches are very aware of it, obviously. They know that she can break the UCLA record with one more three. She's tied it, and they're letting everybody know. Here she is lining up a three. Now she's missed a couple here down the stretch. Samuelson tearing away the rebound and draws the foul. So you can't say Corver is not getting chances.
No question.
UConn by 15 points. They can make plans for Monday night in Oregon. in what really is going to be an interesting matchup with all of those gifted freshmen for the Ducks and the magic carpet ride they're on right now.
I mean, they're a Ruthie Hebert block from not getting past Temple in True. The first round.
Right.
And then they do a great job against Duke. And then, you know, dominating is probably a little strong, but their execution today against Maryland, to me, was fantastic.
In fact, it was the lowest point total for Maryland all season.
Having to go on the road at Duke, this will feel every bit the road game, in fact, more so than at Cameron.
Cornette with a bounce, gets it back. She'll fire the three. Underneath, Burke draws the foul with 2 seconds to go. So the Huskies a couple seconds away from 35-0. Trying to get to Dallas. 11-time national champions going for a fifth consecutive national championship. Gino Auriemma a couple of seconds away from tying the Great Pat Summit for the all-time NCAA tournament wins record. This time of the year, there's so many records up for grabs. Sometimes it's hard to keep them straight, but Korver has checked out. Record-setting day for a tying day for her, for UCLA in career threes. And that's going to do it. UConn wins for the 35th consecutive time and the 110th consecutive game. And it is on to the Elite Eight to take on Oregon. On to another regional final for the 12th consecutive year. That is the second longest D1 record as far as winning streak in any sport all time. Coach Auriemma tying Pat Summit. Nafisa Collier will maybe hear about the foul at the end, but she had a great day. A great day for Gina Auriemma. Final score, 86-71, UConn.
Just as complete a game as you can have if you're Nafisa Collier. They won today the way they've been winning, with Samuelson, Williams, and Collier doing their jobs.
Well, Holly is standing by now with Nafisa Collier.
Well, Nafisa, it's an odd reaction for your team. You've just made it to the Elite Eight, but not a single person was celebrating or smiling through that handshake line. Why were you disappointed with this win?
We didn't end the way we wanted to. We got them a lot of open threes. Second chance shots was exactly what we didn't want them to have, so we just wanted to end on a little bit of a better note.
You had a good game yourself, 27 points, 14 rebounds, but you commit a foul, you foul out, and as you go to the bench, what does Gino Auriemma say to you in that moment?
He told me exactly what it was, which is a stupid foul. I thought I could get a steal, but obviously I didn't, and I really shouldn't have done that with that much time left and with me having four fouls.
How much of the Oregon upset over Maryland did you as a team see today?
We saw up until the third quarter, so we didn't see the fourth.
What concerned you the most about the freedom that they're playing with right now?
They're playing really well, especially getting this far. I mean, I'm happy for them. Something that we really need to work on is not letting them get as many open threes as Maryland did, so I'm sure we'll go over that tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Interesting reaction there, because they're always looking to be perfect, aren't they? At times they were today. Again, our final score, UConn 86, UCLA 71. Our regional final is set, the Huskies and the Ducks.